The Diamond Sutra. Why is Buddha a Buddha, not a Bodhisattva? Sufi masters and Zen masters use this device of hitting. It is a unique to the system for transformation. Sufis use parables, and in each parable there is a camera. For instance, when Imam Jafar Sadiq has his parable, which I used while speaking on seven values of Al-Ghazali, a woman comes to Imam Jafar Sadiq. She said, I have been to many masters, many paths, and each time I moved from one path to the other, it was considered a sign of enlightenment. Now that I have heard about you, I have come to you. When you look at the point of view of the person, he feels that he is a great inquirer. And if you really look from the other side, you will find that the person lacks even the basic tenets. If he has really found something, then why would he need to go to another one? The fact is this, there is something still missing, needs to go to the other. Hazrat Imam Jafar Sadiq listened to her and then said, woman, go back home. I will send you my message soon. Probably in a day or two, the woman found a messenger from Imam Jafar Sadiq. He had a packet in his hand. He handed over the packet to the woman. It has a note. Woman, packet had a bottle which had three layers of sand. Grey sand, red, and black, separated by cotton batting. It was written on the piece of paper, remove the cotton batting and shake the bottle to see what you have reduced yourself to, amounts of confusion. These are the ways through which master teaches. The master hits you so that transformation may be possible in you. For this, he has to devise a methodology. All those stories that a Buddha tells are just preparation for you to connect to your being. These are like hits of Zen masters. And I am doing both. First, I tell you a story, those beautiful stories of trees and mountains and clouds. These are beautiful stories about the other show, beautiful stories of Buddhahood and Bodhisattvahood. These stories are told so that an insatiable quest arises in you. Along the way you were lost, and these stories create an insatiable thirst. You are lost in those stories. That normally happens. These stories hang around you and your attention goes on the jokes of Mullah Nasruddin, the stories, and you may forget the point. That time master gives you a hint. When I see that you are lost in the stories, then I can hit you, and you will not be angry or feel it that I hit you. This is the way all the Buddhas act. The stories only prepare the ground, but the basic work is hammer on your head, hammer on your energy levels. How am I going to create an opening in your solar plexus? Each time when you interact in the outer world of objects, you act according to your own understanding. And you get angry, you get upset, all these sort of things happen. But you are acting according to your conditions. Just look at it, how you used to interact or react with the people and circumstances and situations earlier, and now how do you react or respond to them? There is a vast difference. It is something like this. You have not taken a bath for a long time. Many kind of odors, perspiration accumulate and create a kind of a different kind of a odor. Your natural odor of the body is lost. You will take a little longer time to take a shower. You have dust gathered on your skin or something else. So many other the body scrubs, this and all these devices are used to restore the natural elegance and the fragrance of the body. So these stories and then the hit of the masters is a device to restore the natural health, natural glow of your body. And once that is established, nothing else is to be done. A person called yesterday, "I have a terrible headache since morning. Terrible headache since morning." If you have a terrible headache, go to a doctor. But no doctor can give you a treatment for headache. They will look at the symptom, not the cause of headache. The cause and symptom are two different things. The cause comes as part of your interaction with that particular circumstance and situation. A particular circumstance and situation comes to your interaction according to your own understanding, and as the light has filtered through your body, mind and intellect instruments, the outcome, that is the cause. Person was upset, had a severe headache. I told them, "Let's hold on, and when we start the meditation session, I'll give you the secret. Secret of headache. Does headache have a secret? And what is the secret?" Headache means you have a serious issue in your consciousness that you have been postponing for some time. And unless you handle that, you know that, The headache will not be over, you can keep on, go on taking medicine. And each medicine that you take, analgesic, it has its side effects. It helps you, you take paracetamol. And you look at the broadest spectrum of it. It's a broad spectrum analgesic, but it has many side effects. It affects your stomach feeling. I'm not a medical person, but it's still a little bit here and there, I gather. So, in that situation, if you understand the cause of it, just understanding the cause it is, and it is not, when you go on meditating over the headache, and you will realize it is only at a particular point in you, not spread all over. And that very moment, the issue was, the person is sitting for meditation and someone rings the bell and goes on ringing the bell, and the person who rings the bell happens to be once you're close, once very close to you, person gets a terrible headache. I am talking to you, a meditation session is on. The person who is connected with me in some other way doesn't know what I am doing. He wants to get a bag of flour because there is no flour and he has to cook food. And then rush to go to work. Someone needs mouth freshener. Third one needs something else. He comes and brings him. Because he is in a haste, he rings a bell and expects as soon as bell is sounded, and he is not hearing outside the sound of the bell. I have heard it. It will take me to gather myself in a few moments before I could reach and open the door. The person is restless. He presses the bell again and goes on pressing. What would it do to me? Irritate you. And if you are, let me give you a good example. If you have happened to have invited your boyfriend and girlfriend to spend time together and someone keeps on ringing the bell, you will get a headache, you will get all kinds of reactions. At that moment, your light says, the person who is ringing the bell is in need of getting something from you. Either you inform the person in advance, or do not, just respond. When I have to be out of my home during the evening time, I inform the people in advance. Yet still there are some ignorant ones who do not get the message. One day a person called, he said, I am for 15 minutes, I am by you and I am ringing the bell and you are not coming out. I said, I am not home. How will I come out? And didn't I tell you that I will not be home this evening? He said, I forgot. How you interact or respond to a particular circumstance and situation that determines your belief. So when a master tells you a story, and it is important to create an insatiable quest, be it Zen story, be it Sufi parables, or the jokes of Mulla Nasruddin, It is to create. The stories and the parables are to create an insatiable thirst, and jokes are the device to change your energy. And the moment a quest is created in you, he gives you a hint, gives you a hit. Because my purpose is not the story. These parables is not the story. Not the parable is not the aim. Through this, what I want to communicate to you is important. Through that, what I want to bring into you, to what level of growth I want to take you. Naturally, the work is such that the first the master persuades you. First, I have to persuade you to come closer and closer and closer. Only then, hammer can disable you. Otherwise, you will escape. Though the stories will never allow you to escape. Instead, these will keep you in tune with me. Those beautiful stories function like glue between you and me. And when the master sees the right time has come, he hits. And when the master hits, he hits passionately. This is how transformation is possible. Therefore, the hit of the master are devices for transformation. The topic for this this morning's session I had written as why a Buddha is a Buddha, not a Bodhisattva. First, three things you need to understand. The first stage is the ordinary state of human mind. This is when you cling to the world, to this show. And the other shore seems to be fictitious. You cannot trust the other shore. You cling so much to this shore that the only problem is how to help you to remove such clinging. This is not going to help you. If you start thinking of being a Bodhisattva, this is not going to help in any way. Instead, it will be dangerous. This will only be a strategy to cling to this shore. You are not yet freed of this shore. There is an attraction of this shore as well. This will be a new way for you to cling to the world of being. And this is very tricky. Now, it will be in the name of religion, compassion, love for people, and service. It will be ideological. You may think I am here to help people. This is why I am not going to the other shore. And you do not want to go to the other shore. You do not even know anything about the other shore or it does exist or not. Not only that, you do not even believe that the other shore exists. You are falling into a very subtle trap. This is the first stage of ordinary mind. The ordinary mind clings to the world. In the process, it goes on finding more and more new reasons to cling. It is very difficult to undo this process of clinging. Then comes the second stage. This is the stage of a Bodhisattva. Bodhisattva is one who has come to that unclinging state where he is ready to fly to the other shore. He has no longer roots in this world. In the first place, it is difficult to sever all bondages. In the second stage of Bodhisattva, it is very difficult to cling to the world and its affairs. For the people who are on the first stage, first you have to sever all bondages and destroy your roots in this world as well. When you have destroyed all your roots, only then you can be of help to others. Otherwise, you cannot be of any help to anyone. Many times I have given you the story of Ramakrishna Paramahansa. He is unique. There have been very few enlightened ones who have attained to enlightenment in all its totality. Ramana Maharshi, Jiddu Krishnamurti, George Gurdjieff, Ramakrishna Paramahansa, these come in that category. Ramakrishna has no bondage in him. He is free like a child, innocent. So was Ramana. He had a particular liking for a food. Meditation session is going on. Ramakrishna will leave the session and come in the kitchen and inquire from Sharda. Sharda, what did you cook today? She would say, Ramakrishna Dev, your disciples feel embarrassed. I feel embarrassed to leave the meditation session to come to find out what is being cooked. It doesn't look good for a person like you. At this, Ramakrishna said, Sharda, there isn't anything that can hold me onto this shore. My boat is ready. There is no anchor on it. It can sail any moment, but my work on this planet is not yet over. So I had to create temporary anchors. Sharda thought this is one of the excuses of Ramakrishna for his liking for food. Ramakrishna saw this and for this, we have to thank Sharda's doubt arising in her that Ramakrishna has to reveal the great secret through her for all of us. He said, Sharda, there is nothing in this universe that can hold me onto this shore. It is like the detachment of Krishna is attached and detached simultaneously. Krishna's love for Radha and for the milkmaid may appear to be attachment, but from the side of Krishna, it is not. He is there because he had promised all these milkmaids were the enlightened masters in the past. They were masculine energy and they had not experienced the feminine aspect of love. They did not know anything what happens in the state of when somebody is in the state of truth and love. Krishna, when they prayed, Krishna promised, when I will incarnate as Krishna, you all will come as milkmaid and you will experience the totality of love. Love is femininity. And when the femininity reaches its totality, it becomes meditation. Meditation is masculine and love is feminine. And when meditation attains to totality, it becomes feminine as Buddha became a feminine. So these sages who incarnated along with Krishna as milkmaids, they danced. All the milkmaids want to know, when is my beloved Krishna is coming? It was a total love, total rapture. In that they attained to totality. But Krishna has not come for that alone. That was one aspect of that. Just as when I visit your place, there are many schedules which are predetermined that on this particular day, during this hour, we'll have a talk at this center with great passion. I'll go and have the talk, interact with the people, and when my role is over, I have to go on to the other schedule. When I am on the other schedule, I'll have to forget all about the place which is just completed. If I have not put my total energy into it, the residue will hang around my neck that I have not poured my totality into it. I missed a point here or a point there. But when I am totally into it, I am fulfilled with that. And when I am fulfilled, that fulfillment comes onto the people. And that becomes the force for transformation. People feel a different kind of aura, different kind of energy field surrounding the area. It is not an ordinary lecture. I go on the other event. When I am on the other schedule, there is no remembrance of the past. My role for the first is over, now I am for the second. Krishna's role to give fulfillment to those sages which he has promised in the past life, to give a totality of love, a total experience of love, he has finished that. He has to go on the other end for which he is coming. His schedule is planned that during his visit for 6 days or 7 days or 100 years, he will do all these activities. A pre-planned schedule. A slight variation can be made into adjustments. But broad guidelines are there. Krishna is attached to it as long as he is with those milkmaids. The moment it is over, his role is different. When I am in that session, I am with those people who are participating in that. It is for their sake I am overflowing. But when that session is over, there may be some other messages on my phone, some other calls which I need to attend to when I come back. Such is the nature of the week. And this can happen only when you have severed all the roots with this show. You do not have anything keeping your bondage. Without severing all roots with this shoot. You do not have anything to share. You can go on believing I love people, but I do not have any trace of love as yet. Still you desire people to love you. You are still a beggar. You are not yet in a position to share your love for no reason at all, just for the sheer joy of sharing. When I go to a particular session, I have to quote totality that has happened so that I can connect to all these people, give them a feeling of oneness, and then when you continue the talk, it will have an indelible impression on the consciousness of the person. And when the impression is ingrained on the consciousness, the process of inward journey, the seed of that soul will be first reach to the second stage, sever all ties with this world. When you do not cling to anything, only then you can be utterly egoless. Destroy all your roots in this world, be not possessive. Only then what Buddha is saying will be relevant to you. Then again the problem will arise. First the problem is how to uncling, and then the problem will arise how to cling a little more, a little longer to that. Because sometimes it happens, the program is scheduled for a certain time. Then on reaching there, you realize you need to stay a little longer in that session. Still there are people who wants to connect to you. And just the way you connect to them, you can create something, a question them, plant a seed or something. Although it was not scheduled. The purpose is not just to go and deliver a proof. Is to prepare the people who have gathered there for their onward journey, a loving gesture for someone, a few words of comfort to that person, an assurance, you have no problem, you can call me anytime you need to give me a call or send me a message. That assurance is more than enough. You have to stay a little longer in that session. And where I will spare the time for that a little longer to stay? Remember, after that session, there may be another session after 2 hours. That session has to go on as scheduled. I will take out half an hour from my session, from my releases, to dedicate to those people who are in need of this opportunity. Buddha says, when you have no roots, only then you are needed. Then you have something to offer. Then you have something to share. Then you have diamonds to share. Then before leaving share and remain here as long as you can, this is the second stage. The third stage is of Buddha who has reached to the other shore. Now you ask, and why then a Buddha is a Buddha, not a Bodhisattva? The third stage is even more difficult. To be on the other shore, in the realm of beyond this, and yet to be on this shore, is the most difficult thing. You are in the Alamega, yet still you are connected to this shore. To be on the other shore and yet still go on helping the people is most difficult one. Sufis call this as Alamega, the realm of the beyond. From that realm, the Buddha is trying to connect that it is you who has to make the most difficult. Because you remember, without the body, without the mind and intellect, I cannot interact with you. I am using my body vehicle, the voice, and all these things to connect to you. But when I am in a bodiless consciousness, I cannot speak with you, I am speaking you. Then how can I communicate to you? It is like the television or the radio broadcast is over. While it is live, you did not hear it. Now you want to hear it. Suddenly someone says, I have a recording of that. Oh, really? You have a recording of that? Can I get it, please? You can connect to the divine archives. So the one who is on this show, he has a strong connectivity to those masters who have entered into Alamega, to the Buddha who has reached to the other shore, and through the method of Kashi, through the other methods, he connects to you. It is said that Hazrat Shah Bahauddin Naqshband Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu got his initial training with the masters, with the sheikh, who had left this finite world many lives. Buddha is trying to connect, but it is you who has to make most of the effort to connect, and the problems become difficult when you cannot connect. So these are three difficulties. First requires to unplug from this shore. Second requires to remain on this shore. Only when unplugging has happened, and the third happens when you cannot remain on this shore. Remember, in the process of transformation, a moment comes when it becomes difficult, almost impossible to connect to this shore. We cannot connect to this shore at all. I have no interest to live in this world, but I have to. Every bodhisattva has to become a Buddha. You cannot cling to this shore. The point comes when you have to be. A little is possible at the most, one life. More than that, I am not possible. then you will have to live. One life you can clean, because all the roots are destroyed, but you have the body. You can renew the body. So Ramakrishna said, told Sharda, the moment I turned my face from the food, 3 days after I'll be living. He created a human. He created an angel. Sharda thought this is an excuse like any other person. And it happened in the last stage of his life. Ramakrishna had throat cancer. He was lying on the bed. Sharda came one morning with a platter full of food in his inner hands. She said, Ramakrishna Dev, look, come and eat. I have brought all the favorite dishes that you like. Ramakrishna, whose face was turned on the other side towards the wall, turned his face towards Sharda, looked at her as if trying to answer something. Then looked at the plate, platter, and saying this, he turned his face to the other side. Sharda remembered the words of an enlightened, awakened Ramakrishna many years back. The day I will turn my face from the food to the last one. And exactly like that happened. 3 days after, Ramakrishna was born. So one more life you can claim, because all the roots are destroyed, but you have body and you can remain in the body. You have no attachments with this one, that one, or anything else. But you can create an anchor to the body. One life you can clean at the most, then you are bound to be. The third stage is that of a Buddha. Buddha is one who has left and yet goes on helping the people. But remember, if you have been a bodhisattva, only then you will be able in the third stage to help people, not others. There are two words to be understood. One is arhat and the other is bodhisattva. Arhat is one in whom the world is lonely. These are the Buddhist terminology. In discipline of transcendence of Buddha, these various stages that a seeker has to go through have been explained. The Shrotpan, the Arhat, the Bodhisattva, the Buddha. Arhat is one in whom the world is no more. He has no attachment. The ego is gone. But then immediately he moves to the other shore. He is called Arhat. He does not bother about others. He simply goes to the other shore when he is ready. He is not there to help the people. Arhat will not be able to, will not be of any help from the other shore, because he will not know who, will not know how to help. How do you think I know to help the people beyond time and space? People get benefited beyond time and space, and then you go on saying that the speed at which the progress takes place is tremendous. One has to be trained to help others. A bodhisattva is also in the same state. As an arhat, he has known, he has seen, he has become truth, but he stays on this shore a little longer and goes on helping people in whatsoever way he can. He learns the way of help. This is the difference between arhat and a bodhisattva. One is that you have finished your PhD. The other is, after finishing your PhD, you enter in the vocation of teaching and you devise the methods to help the other students who will come. You will understand their psychology, their needs, and you go on helping them. If you have been a bodhisattva, this is the nature of a bodhisattva. Arhat is like the one who has finished his PhD and that's it. The other is bodhisattva who stays on in this business. He understands all the research journals. I recall when I was in the research field, the students will come, even sometimes the other professors, because of my sharpness of the memory, they will ask if I recall any of this particular paper or something like this. I will give them the exact reference. I know in each of the books that have been authored by me what different topics have been explained. I am free to that. If you have been a bodhisattva and then you go to the other shore, there you will find on the other shore arhat, who has also become a Buddha and bodhisattva, will also become a Buddha. The other shore is the shore of Buddhahood, but the one who has been a bodhisattva on this shore will be able to help from the other shore as well, just as one who has decided to take research as his profession, teaching as his profession, he will have to move differently than he has completed his degree and moves out of that, enters into anything. Buddha goes on helping down the centuries. However, this is not the case of a bodhisattva. That is why when Subhuti asks, will there be any who will understand these sutras when spoken 500 years or 1000 years after? Even now, if you are open to Buddha, to Jesus, to Krishna, the help will certainly be coming to you. The message is available in the Akashic records. One day science will discover. The work is still going on in this field. Even now, if you are passionately in love with Buddha, the help will be coming to you. He is still calling you from the other shore, but the shout from the other shore is very far away. You will have to listen very attentively. You will have to listen more attentively than you are listening to me now. Sooner or later, I will be gone too. If you learn how to listen to me attentively while on this show, he prepares you so that you can listen to him from the other show as well. When the master is alive, you pay your attention to him. When he is no more, you lament. You go on lamenting that now your grace is meaningless. And then the compassion of the master flows Open your eyes, the inner one, and look no redness in the empty of this subtle presence of the masters who have gone to the other shore. The grace is ever present. Only you have to develop the inner vision. Buddhahood is the ultimate state of consciousness. But if you pass through Bodhisattva, only then you will be available to the world. You will be a window to God forever. If you do not pass through the Bodhisattva, you will disappear into the infinite. But nobody will ever be helped by you.